Hello, investors, and welcome to our session here today. So last week, we entered in an earnings trade. You know, earnings trades can be beneficial. They can also be somewhat heartbreaking. Usually they're short-term in nature. Sometimes they can float your boat, and sometimes they can sink your boat. Let me just take care of something right here. All right. Anyway, we'll take a look to see what our last trade that we did on earnings did last week, and then we'll talk about some of the things that we can avoid, those situations that might sink our boat. But before we get too far along, let's go ahead and pop through our disclosures here. Just to remind investors that options carry a high level risk and are not suitable for all investors. Certain requirements must be met to trade options through Schwab. Multi-leg option strategies will involve multiple commissions, so we want to be mindful of that. Also, keep in mind the information presented here is for general informational purposes only, should not be considered an individualized recommendation or endorsement of any particular security, chart pattern, or investment strategy. For the sake of simplicity, the examples in this presentation do not take into consideration commission and other transaction fees. We'd use the PaperMoney software application here. This is for educational purposes only. Keep in mind that successful virtual trading during one time period does not guarantee successful investing of actual funds during a later time period, as market conditions do change continuously. We'll discuss the Greeks as we're going along here. It's also important to keep in mind that short options can be assigned at any time up to expiration, regardless of the in-the-money amount. An in-the-money option has a high risk of being assigned early. It's important to keep that in mind because the PaperMoney virtual trading application will not assign a short position early, which is different from what could occur in a real trading account. Now, having said that, we will discuss a class of options that actually are not going to be assigned early. And we'll discuss that. We'll talk about that particular class of options and have that as part of our discussion here today. Do be mindful, though, that past performance of any security or strategy does not guarantee future results or success. All right, so that, investors, let's just go ahead and I'm going to pull the thinkorswim platform so we can just jump right into our discussion here. We'll take a look at the trade that we put on last week, and that trade was not on Tesla. That trade was on Taiwan Semiconductor. This was an earnings trade. And we'll have it up here in just a moment. This was an earnings trade, okay? And this is an example, I guess you could say, of a torpedo hitting your boat and sinking it and possibly sinking it quickly. Some of you will remember from last week that in putting on this trade together, we used the market maker move from thinkorswim. That's a proprietary indicator that suggests a potential zone that the underlying security will be trading in over a specified event. I'm just going to see if I can grab a drawing tool here for just a second. We'll make some notes as we're going along here. There we go. All right, and what the market maker move suggests when we enter the trade, and we basically enter the trade right here, day before that earnings announcement, the market maker move suggested the underlying security would stay within this zone right here. And putting on this trade, we sold a short call vertical up above here. And we sold a short put vertical down below here. This was basically a two-day trade. We entered it in on Wednesday, and the underlying options expired on Friday. So I guess it would be more along the lines of about a two-and-a-half-day trade. As long as the underlying security stayed within the anticipated market maker move right here, you know, stayed at or below that point or at or above this point, then again, the trade would likely be successful. However, you can see that we blew all the way out of it. We gapped all the way up here. And in gapping all the way up here, actually, it looks like we gapped all the way up there. We pulled down a little bit, and then we went up a little bit. And then we've just primarily been moving up by then. Now, since then, what's interesting to see, we can see right here that the Taiwan Semiconductor had about 3 days bucking above this resistance level, breaking above resistance now, continuing to go to the strong side. So this particular trade, when you get blown out like that, you're basically sitting at your maximum loss. And that's what happened on this particular trade is we incurred a loss equal to or greater than what the maximum loss was when we first entered the trade. Now, one of the nice things about earnings is that it provides you an ample opportunity to enter in trades and strategies similar to this strategy that can provide you with some rather rapid earnings, I should say rapid profitability on your individual trades. But on the other side of it, it can blow you out when you just have a couple of days in those situations. There is not a whole lot you can do. Well, what are we looking at right now with regards to earnings and the earnings season? Let's take this guy off of here for now. Going to open up our left-hand side right here, and let's pull up the S&P 500 right here. We'll bring this up right here, and look at all the earnings. I mean, there's many more stocks that have earnings coming up than stocks that aren't, that don't have earnings coming up. I think I was looking at a report yesterday where we're looking at one day, and in one day there were like 57 companies with decent market caps and companies that have decent followings that were coming out with their earnings after the market closed. So a lot of earnings going on here. When you have this type of a situation, what are some things you can do to avoid a situation like this where those earnings are going to sink your boat? Well, one of the things you can do, investor, is you can choose to do an option trade on a security that is not directly impacted by the earnings announcement that comes out on an individual stock. And what we're talking about now is we're talking about doing an option trade on indexes rather than individual companies. And we'll swing back out and we'll take a look at that. We do want to come in here and take a look at a previous position we put on. Then we'll come back out here and we'll take a look at trading options on indexes and some of the unique characteristics of indexes when you do that. But as long as we're talking about Taiwan Semiconductor, let's come back in here and assess. I do believe we have another existing position in here. So this is Shopify. Shop looks like we have 9 days till expiration on this one. Looks like we do have some profitability right here. The stock's currently trading at 81.88. Our short strike price on this is at 76. So we want the underlying security to stay at or above $76. We're sitting here at 81. Let's take a look at the chart to see where we're currently at. We did five of these, 81, 76. We'll come back over here to our chart and let's bring up Shopify and think about that $76 level. They're right there. So here we are. What's this guy right here? That's 76. So as long as we stay above this line here, we're in a pretty good place to capture our maximum gain on this. We don't know that we'll capture our maximum gain on this. And the reality is maximum gain is theoretical because in a maximum gain situation, there's still those possibilities that if a short option, even though it's out of the money, it could be exercised. We're talking about short options on individual securities. We will take a look at an exception to that in relationship to that, okay? But this is what we're looking at here on Shopify. So it looks like so far this security tends to be looking like it's pretty good shape. In fact, we have an inverted head and shoulders pattern, which is a continuation pattern if it's part of an uptrend. Came here, a little bit of a dip here, dip here, dip here. We can just identify the neckline on that head and shoulders pattern, like so. And we'll be looking at this trade having some additional gusto if we're able to break above that neckline right there, okay? Well, investors, let's talk a little bit about then trading indexes, because the nice thing about trading an index is you don't have that same level of risk related to an earnings announcement. Now, an earnings announcement primarily affects an individual stock. When you're talking about an index, for example, the S&P 500, that's an average of 500 individual stocks. So one stock can have a little bit of effect, but it's going to be a fairly small impact versus trading the individual stock itself. And a lot of times that potential small impact is going to be completely offset by the other 499 stocks. So you don't even experience it or you don't even see it. It is somewhat sensitive though, however, to the market cap of the individual stock. For example, if we had earnings coming out on say Meta, Microsoft, Apple, Amazon, some of these large mega cap companies, they may actually have more of an impact with regards to some of the major indices than say smaller cap stocks in relationship to those. But let's shift gears here a little bit and take a look at a couple of charts here to see if possibly we might have a technical situation that would justify an option trade on an index. We can see over here we have SPX and we have it breaking above the resistance level. Now, before I get into these and kind of start tearing these apart, I do want to take a peek over in the chat window and welcome everybody here. So we do want to welcome Dragon Rider. Welcome to Debbie and welcome to Bernard and James and Nancy and Don and Jody and Robert and Odessa. Truth will always prevail. Barat and Robert and Speak the Truth. And everybody else, Joe, Revamp. And it looks like we have Michael Fairborn here with us today. Great to have Mike here with us today. Very knowledgeable investor. Do feel free to send your questions over there to Mike. I'll also try to peek over there periodically and help out as well. Well, look at the S&P 500. We can see that it came up here, and it came up here, and it had a little bit of difficulty breaking above this resistance level. Not a lot of difficulty, but a little bit of difficulty. This was our real resistance breakout right here, right at that point right there where we broke out of that. What is that? That's about it's 47.99. Let's just make that the 4800 level. Breaking above that 4800 level and then continuing to move up. But we did have a pause here and another breakout and continue to move to the upside. If we look at today's candlestick, that candlestick is referred to as a spinning top. It does represent a potential pause and could represent a potential reverse in direction. It hasn't happened yet, though. Right now, we just have that little spinning top right there. Notice we had a spinning top here. We did have a pause the following day. Then we got right back in gear. When you have a spinning top, one of the challenges you have with this when it gaps up here and have a spinning top like this is to look for the next trading day. And on the next trading day, if the underlying security gaps down from that spinning top and the body and the shadows of that candle that is created on the following day does not go into this little spinning top. In other words, it gaps down here, and no part of yesterday's candle would be included in the price range of the spinning top. Then you have what's called an abandoned baby bottom, an abandoned baby top. That abandoned baby top does suggest a continued move to the downside, but we don't have that. Right now, we just have a spinning top. Maybe we get a pause and we continue to move to the upside. So that is the S&P 500. Can we trade the S&P 500? Well, we can't buy the S&P 500 the same way that we buy a stock, but we can buy options related to the S&P 500. If we come over here and choose trade, and let's put up here SPX. And here we have the options that we can trade on the S&P 500. Now, there's a couple of important points to keep in mind if we're going to trade options on the SPX. And also, I guess you could say the brother of the SPX is the XSP. That's the micro S&P 500, and it also has options. The difference between the SPX and the XSP is the XSP is 1/10 of the value of the SPX. So if you put together an option trade on the S&P 500 and you look at your risk related to that and you're saying these numbers are a little bit high for me, then you might want to look at the XSP, which is 1/10 of the S&P 500. We'll take a look at that in a little bit more detail here a little bit later on in our discussion. Okay. Couple things to keep in mind, though, investors in relationship to these. Let me just grab a drawing tool with regards to the SPX right here, okay? And also, we're going to talk about the XSP. These options have what's called a European settlement. What does European settlement mean? Well, one thing, this is probably one of the biggest differences you'll see between a European settlement option and the standard options that we trade on in individual companies is European settlement options. They don't have the early assignment risk that is involved when you have a standard option. In other words, if you have a short vertical and your short option goes in the money and there's still 3 weeks before the option expires. Well, if that's occurred on a standard stock, that short option can be exercised at any time. The reality is it doesn't even have to be in the money. A short option that is out of the money can also be exercised at any time. That's not the case with European-style options. European-style options can only be exercised on the last business day before the expiration of the option. That's the only time that they can be exercised. Now another thing to keep in mind with regards to European style option is that they are cash settled, which basically means once you enter the trade, you don't have to worry too much about exiting the trade. If you're looking at holding it through expiration, you can go in, and you can sell them, you can buy them back, and do those types of things. You can close those positions earlier. You can close those positions before expiration. It's just you don't have to worry about that assignment occurring if you have that short option before the last business day, before the expiration. Okay? But one of the nice things about these is that these are going to be cash settled. So when you look at the strike price and you look at the price of the underlying security and you calculate the intrinsic or the extrinsic value of that option, That will tell you how much intrinsic value it has. If the option has intrinsic value based on the strike price and the price that's used to determine that, then the cash related to that intrinsic value will just move into your account. You don't have to go out and close anything. You don't, that is not a necessary thing to do if you hold these things up to the expiration. Now, it's important to keep in mind with regards to the expiration, I said these options expire on Friday. However, the last day that you can take action on as far as buying and selling them and closing them out is the last business day before the expiration day. So if you've got an option and it expires on Friday, and most of these do have expirations on Friday, keep in mind that what happens is they stop trading at the end of trading on Thursday. And then the first print that occurs on Friday, that first Friday morning print, that print or that value is used to determine the cash. That print is used to determine the value of that option. Whatever the value of that option is in comparison to when you enter the trade, then you're going to be able to get the cash value of that. Okay. So keep in mind, they are cash settled, which is nice because you don't have to do a lot of things as part of the expiration in relationship to that. Okay. So do keep those important considerations. Again, just a reminder, no concern about early assignment when you're using European style, and the options, the last day that you can trade these options is the last business day before the expiration. That's the last time you can trade them. And the value of your cash settlement is determined by the first print on the expiration day. That first morning when they open up and you get that first value, compare that to the strike price, and that determines the cash settlement that you will receive on that particular option, okay? So with that in mind then, let's take a look at a couple things here. Again, keep in mind now we're looking at trading these index options, so we don't have a lot of that risk that's involved with trading an individual stock over an earnings announcement. This gives us a place to trade without dealing with some of those sink your boat moves that can occur when you're trading individual options. Just a quick review. We talked about one that we did on Taiwan Semiconductor where the stock went way higher than what we thought it would based on the market maker move. Obviously, the market maker move did not correctly calculate this. And we mentioned that those things happened. We also position sized based on the potential maximum loss. We said we're okay with it. We were playing the part of that investor. There's also situations where a stock will go down much greater than what the market maker move. I think Archer Daniel Midlands was the case. I did not run what the market maker move was here on Archer Daniel Midland, but I am assuming it was not down here. Okay, so if we did the same type of strategy that we did on Taiwan Semiconductor, in other words, do a short call vertical, a short put vertical outside the market maker move, this trade most likely would have been unprofitable as well. Now, there are some other strategies that we can try around earnings, and perhaps we still have some earnings stock next week. We'll try, well, you know, I say, yeah, so there are some other strategies related to earnings announcement, but they don't involve short verticals in the way that we use short verticals in here, okay? But tomorrow, I teach a selecting an option strategy. We may do a different type of an earnings trade that gives a little bit more flexibility in the event the stock moves against us in relationship to that. Okay. All right. Well, let's come back over here then. We're going to stay over here for a second, and I'm going to put in SPX here. We'll just pull up the chart and identify a couple things. We're looking at SPX. We've got right here, we have a little bit of a breakout. Let's get a line right here. You'll see right here, stuck it at 1-2 days and it broke out. All right. So I would call that like a mini breakout. It is not a very significant breakout, to be honest with you. You know, a breakout is significant based on how many times a stock has hit it, how recent it has hit it, and how much volume has been done. Now, we don't have volume with regards to the SPX. So it's more along the lines of how many times it hit it twice. Okay. Would like to be able to go back here and see several hits back in time, but because the SPX is trading at some of these all-time highs, we're not going to see that, okay? But that still could be considered to be a breakout right there. And let's just identify a price level right there, breakout right there. Now here is a more is a much more impressive breakout right here. Why do I say that? Because we just about got it here. So we almost have one. We definitely have two. We have three, four, five, six, and then we have took a big green candle to break us out. So this is a more significant breakout level right here. So let's come over here and let's identify this level here on the left. So 47.93. It would be nice if we're looking at this from a short vertical standpoint, if we could do a short put vertical all the way down here. I don't know that we can and get a decent level of profitability because we're so far away from this. The ideal time to write this trade would have been right there, okay? But can we get something about, you know, 47.93, 47? So 47.91 would be great, okay? Again, I don't know if we're going to get there. Also keep in mind, as the underlying indices go up, what happens to implied volatility? Implied volatility goes down, which further hampers our effort to create some distance between our short strike prices and this level of resistance that we are breaking through. As the underlying indices go down, implied volatility tends to go up. Okay? But if I pull up the VIX, which is simply the implied volatility on the S&P 500, I think we're going to see that it's fairly low because of this big run that we've made. We come up here and pull up the VIX. Yeah, it's fairly low. It's down here. Now, this doesn't mean that short verticals are off the table. It just means that we should not anticipate getting the type of returns that we would have when the VIX is all the way up here, back here in this October timeframe. Back here in this October timeframe, this is probably when the SPX had taken a dip. Let's go back over to the SPX. And there's the dip right there in October. That pushed that up there. Okay. Let's see what we can do here, though, as far as putting together a trade. Then we'll take a look at this as well as the cousin of this XSP, right? I'm going to come up here to the trade page, and here we have our stuff here for SPX. Let's come down here. Let's go out here a little while, maybe come out here about 30 days. One of the reasons I'm coming out here 30 days, see if we can get some kind of a see if we can move that down to about the 4,800 level. I don't know that we'll be able to do that, but let's see. Coming down here, so what have we got? We've got $5 increments on the strike prices here. Sometimes if we're a little bit shorter time frame, we can get dollar increments. I'm not seeing it there. Maybe that's going to be on XSP. Maybe we'll swing back over on XSP, but let's come out here about 30 days. We've got in here, we've usually used a delta that is less than 30 to have a 70% theoretical probability of success. So let's get some more strike prices in here because we want to get some deltas. That there's a 29 delta right there. That's at 4830. Can we get down? Let's go 35. Let's just see what the premium looks like when we are at when we're below the 4800. Wow, these guys, lots of strike price. Okay, so there's the 4,800. Okay, the 4,800 would put us just below. 4,800 would put us, actually put us just on that. We actually want to do 4,793. 4,790. Okay, we'll come all the way down here to 4,790. I don't know what kind of credit we're going to get. I don't even know if it's going to be worth it being this far out of the money, but. So we got here at 47.90. I'm going to do right click right here. What's our theoretical probability of success, investors? We have a delta here of 0.22. Delta here of 0.22. So our theoretical probability of success, just theoretical, is going to be 100 minus the delta. So our theoretical probability of success would be 78%. Again, it's theoretical. I'm going to do right click right here. I'm going to choose sell. We're going to go vertical. There it is right there. We're looking at 80 cents, somewhere between 80 and 50 cents on a $5 wide spread with a 78% probability of success. Let's come over here and see what we got here in relationship to this, okay? So we're $5 wide, we're getting an 80 cent credit. So if I pick up my 80 cents, and I'm $5 wide, then my theoretical risk is the $5 minus the 80 cents, which is 420. Let's try that again. 80 divided by 420. So look at a 19% return over 30 days. I don't know. That's kind of narrow. We tried to get on these, we tried to get about a 1% return for each day that we're in the trade. But now we're trading indexes. So indexes is a little bit of a different animal. So we may not be able to meet those parameters. Also, our probability of success on this is 78% rather than 70%, which is usually what we're going to be looking for. Okay. So let's ratchet things up here just a little bit and come up here to, I'm going to come here to the 29 one. Okay. So this one here, we have a 71% probability of success at the 48.30. We'll click here to sell vertical. Okay. I've got $1.20 on $5 wide. $1.20 on $5 wide. So $5 wide. $5 minus 120. Risk of 380, 120 divided by 380. It gives me a 31% return over 30 days. Okay, so that one's okay. If we're playing the part of the investor that wants to get at least a 1% return and a 70% probability. But what does this look like on the chart? Do we feel comfortable about where our short strike price is on the chart? And that is at 48.30. We'll come over here. 48.30 chart. I'm going to move this up to 48.30. Let's just move this one down to 48.30. Set of properties, 48.30. We have, well, you know, if you look at it, this thing hit resistance, it also established a support level right there. So we're a little bit below a mini support level, a couple of days of a bounce. Okay, so that would be a possibility. Okay, and this would alleviate issues in relationship to earnings announcements and the like. We just put in a short vertical like this and run it like this. Okay, now I'm going to go ahead and take this off of here. Now let's go ahead and run the numbers. This is the number. Is this the one we have here? 48.30, 48.25. Yeah, this is the one we have. So let's take a look at our numbers here. If we wanted to trade SPX, I'm going to do a confirm and send right here. Okay, so for each contract, our maximum loss is $390. Okay. When I click this, it must have been at 110. Let's just lock that in at 110. That's kind of bounced around a little bit. Our maximum loss would be $390. Our maximum profit would be 110. And there are transaction fees related to this. Maybe we're saying, you know, in these kind of markets, maybe I don't want to risk that much. I want to step down to something a little bit not quite so high. Also, maybe something that we could fine tune a little bit more and get out of this $5 range thing. Well, then we could come over here and look at how about the mini on this one, or the micro, I guess you call it. And that is going to be XSP. Well, XSP, you can see this chart is essentially the same, only now instead of 4,800 here, we have 490. So it's 1/10 of that previous chart, 1/10 of this. Well, let's see what this looks like then as far as risk and liquidity, strike price choices and the like. We'll come up here to the trade page. Hey, by the way, XSP is also European style. So XSP, SPX, both European style. Come over here and let's go out about 30 days once again. And one thing that kind of jumps out at you here is a lot of these strike prices are dollar increments. Kind of have a weird one here. 50 cents right there, 50 cents right there. I don't know why those things are coming in there, that 50 cent thing. That's weird. Okay. And then over here we have our deltas. And if we want to come over here and put a delta below 30 or below, yeah, just a little bit below 30, we'd be sitting here at 483. Let's see what this looks like. I want to be a dollar wide, so I'm going to go two strike prices on this because this is 42.50. This goes 483 to 482. So let's do that. I'm going to do right click here. We're going to choose sell. I'm going to go deep and wide because I want to skip that 50 cent one. 1 month, two strikes, vertical, and 23. I'm going to just lock that in at 23. Now, notice that the slippage between the mid and the natural here is rather extensive, okay? But if we can get a good fill on this, and we're totally okay with a maximum loss, then the challenge of the slippage is really only up front. Because on the back side of this, it's going to be cash settled, okay? And so we don't need to worry about, oh, there's slippage here, there's slippage there, when I'm going to get out of this thing. I can just let those options go all the way through expiration. It'll be cash settled based on what? The strike price of the option and the first print on the day of expiration, which is going to be the Friday following that Thursday under almost all circumstances, okay? Oh, well, let's see what we got here then. If we're able to catch this, these numbers are bouncing around here. I'm going to hold tight here to the 23. But what does 483 look like on the chart? Come up here and let's bring a 483 up here. 483. There's our 483. Again, we're sitting down below this little support level. There's our spinning top up there. Let's put a label on this. Put it over there to the right. Okay, there we have it right there. How much risk do we have on this one? Well, it's 1/10 of what we're looking at before here, right? So our maximum loss now is $77 rather than $770. Our maximum profit is $23 rather than $230. Okay, so you want to keep that in mind. And then there are transaction fees related to this, so we want to keep that in mind in relationship to the transaction fees. Okay, it's always important to note. Please know you select a weekly option series with non-standard expiration date. So looking at this, our maximum loss then is 77. Maybe we want to do a few more contracts on this. Maybe we're okay with about five, if we did five of these. Five of these, and let's see if we can get a fill here at 23. This would be one that would probably leave in there and give it maybe 15, 20 minutes, maybe half an hour to get filled, okay? And it may take that long, or we may not get filled. We know in here that we don't take a credit of less than 21. We may take a 22. But because of transaction fees, we've opted to play the investor that needs to get at least 21 in these types of situations. Okay. We'll do investors. We'll go ahead and play the part of the investor that's okay going with these lower quantities and has theoretical risk here of what? 5 times 70 equals $350. Now let's see, if we're getting 23 and these are a dollar wide. Let's calculate this exactly. $1 wide minus 23, 77 times 5 equals about $385, okay? If we're okay with that. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and get ready to, we'll go ahead and play the part of the investors looking at this micro, but I do want to take one peek over here in the chat window to see if there's something I can help out with, because sometimes I can see something here where I have the platform and Mike doesn't have availability to that. There may be something I can help out here with. Yeah, looks like Mike's doing a good job of taking care of all of your questions here. And Bo brings up a great point. It's the first trade of each individual stock when the market opens for regular trading hours. Yeah, you take each individual stock that makes up the index that's used to make that calculation. You got to add up all 500 of those things, then they'll come up with the number that's used in determining where you're at on that calculation. Okay. All right, yeah, again, a big thanks to Mike for helping out with questions over here. Let's see if we can get a fill here then. We got five of these. I'm going to do a confirm right here. And please note you've selected a weekly option series with non-standard expiration date. We could go ahead and click on send. Have our numbers right here. Short verticals, It's off to the races. Okay, so usually in the situation like this, investor would give it maybe 10, 15, 20 minutes. In an effort to get filled, I'm going to take 1 cent off of this, but I'm not going to take more than a cent off of it. So we'll come up here to monitor and working orders. Here is our vertical right here. Do a right click and choose cancel replace. I'm going to take 1 penny off of that. Do a confirm and send. And well, it looks like we got filled with the 1 penny. So what we'll do is we'll go ahead and follow up on that one. And again, so this is on the S&P 500. So is there a lot of concern about some of the earnings that are coming out here tomorrow? I mean, what do we got coming out here? We got, let's take our S&P 500. Let's sort it by market cap. We've got Apple's coming out. When's Apple coming out here? I don't have the exact date here. If I get a click on this, Apple's on 2/1 coming up. Microsoft's on 2/14. So you just have all these earnings coming out over the next little while. And we're going to be avoiding, for the most part. Now, as I said, the larger cap ones, they will have somewhat of an impact on these ones. Okay. However, they won't have the same impact they won't have nearly the same impact as if we were trading the individual security by itself. Now, how are we doing on time? It looks like we're doing okay on time. Another one may be of interest to us, and that's going to be the Russell. Come over here and take a peek right here. So here is the Russell. This Russell is 1,984. Well, you know what? We have a micro for the Russell as well. And we can pull that one up. That's going to be the MRUT. Or we may want to just trade the Russell all by itself here. Let's come over here. And so we've got, if we want to come out here 20, how about 16 days? See, we can go a little bit shorter here on the Russell. 16 days and a delta of 30. $5 wide strike prices. Come in here and choose sell. Vertical. Right there. Well, you know what? That's 16 days, and you know, I don't know if we'll get a $1.40 here. Let's go for $1.20. Well, we'll come down here. Don't want to go too far. How about $1.35? Okay. And what does 1945 look like on the chart for the Russell? Come here to the chart for the Russell. 1945. Let's grab one of these lines right here. Things go with 1945 on this guy. 1945. Ooh, okay. So that's sitting right on this support line right here, right? I'd like to get a little bit below that support line. It's also sitting right at the bottom of this breakout. This zone right here, this window, represents a support level. It'd be nice to get a little bit below that. Let's see if we can go $5 lower and still get a return that maybe it'd be okay. So 1945, let's go to 1940 and 1935 and 130, maybe move that down. Well, we'll go ahead and try to get 130. We'll see what we can do. Still, that's at 1940 now. So let's move this down to 1940. That should put us below. It doesn't put us by much, but look, it puts us on this support level just a little bit below here. We're $5 wide. I'm going to go a little bit lower. You know, when you get to a point where this thing drops way below a dollar, it's kind of like, I don't know, you know, but let's go a little bit lower. Let's go 1935, 1930. Take that off. That's still $1.20. Come in here and change this to then 1935. And put it right there. It puts a little bit lower. Yeah, let's go ahead. We'll play the part of the investor that's okay with this. Now, this is the Russell, okay? So we can trade the Russell, or we can trade the micro on the Russell, the micro. Let me ask you guys. I'm going to throw this up to a chain. The micro on the Russell is going to be 1/10 of this. So what do you want to trade? Just go ahead and chat into the chat window. Rut. Or MRUT, RUT for the Russell, or MRUT for the micro Russell. The micro Russell, just going to make a note here, we're at 1935, 1930. The MRUT's going to look the same as this, but chat in over there. Which one do you want to go? The one's going to be one-tenth of the other. The MRUT chart looks almost identical, right? Chart is almost identical. We come up here to trade. And where would we be here on the Russell? 16 days out. Here's our deltas, maybe coming down here to 194. 194, 190. That's interesting. Goes to two. You know, you get down here in these areas. Why don't we do this? 195, 194. Let's check this one out. And vertical. Okay, so that's 30 cents. Okay, I'm going to come over here and take a peek. What are we looking at, guys? The Russell, MRUT, RUT, RUT, MRUT, RUT, MRUT, MRUT. It looks like I have a few more MRUTs, okay? Not by much, okay? But the micro wins out by a touch, okay? So we'll go ahead and go in here with the micro, all right? 195. Let's see what this looks like on the chart. See, we want to be on this chart, 195, 195. Okay. I'd like to be a little bit lower. Can I go a 194, 193? That's not traded. 192. Oh, they're kind of getting us on these strike prices. That's frustrating. If I go 194 and one, that's going to be a $4 wide. If I go 192, let's go with $2.50 wide. We'll go with that. 192, 190. Okay. So it's 192.50 and then 190. And a 44 cent credit. Okay, let's do that. And we'll quickly run through our risk reward here. Then we'll go ahead and wrap things up here real fast. Okay, so looking at this, we're going to try to get 40 cents and we are $2.50 wide, right? So I take $2.50, I subtract from that 40 cents. My theoretical risk here, $2.50, subtract from that 40 cents. My theoretical risk is going to be 210. So I take 40 here divided by 210. And I get a 19% return over 16 days. Okay. So that looks to me like that meets our parameters. You know, we'd like to get 1% per day. We're just playing the part of the investor that would like to get that. Our delta here is 32, so it's not quite, the delta isn't quite where we would like it to be. Well, actually, we're sitting here at 192.50, so our delta is actually 23, so it's actually like a 77 delta right there. So on these ones, our risk was about 240. Let's go ahead and say we're okay with five of these. Three, four, five, okay. And let's try to get, notice our liquidity is much better on these. 37.45, that's a lot better liquidity right there. Do a confirm and send here. I always want to read the notes in here. Maximum profit 220, maximum loss 1,000. Okay. And we have our other numbers here. Please know that you've selected a weekly option series with non-standard expiration. We know that. We also know that they're European style, so we don't have to worry about assignment or anything until the last trading day before the expiration day. And they also are cash settled as well. So we'll go ahead and send that in. And we got filled. Okay, investors, let's go ahead and wrap things up here for today, all right? So what do we want to do here today? Well, we just want to talk about options. We want to talk about earnings. We want to talk about what can we do to avoid all the volatility of the earnings, some of those big moves that just hit us like a torpedo and sink our boats. Well, one of the things we do is just not trade individual stocks and to look at possibly trading some of the indexes. And we talked about that, talked about some of the unique characteristics of some of those indexes, some of which are our European expiration, we went over those. Hey, just a little reminder, you can follow me on X, formerly Twitter. That is going to be at Ken Rose CS on there. I also encourage you to follow Mike on X, formerly Twitter as well. Again, a big thanks to Mike for handling all the questions over there. Also, circle your calendars for this Monday at 2 p.m. Eastern Time. Mike teaches an excellent covered calls and short put session, so you don't want to miss that one as well. Hi, everybody. Thanks again for joining us here today for Short Verticals. Hope you have a fantastic rest of your day. Best of success in your investing, and hope to see you back here again next time. Bye, everybody. We'll see you later, and thanks again.